we can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life, Lou Pleafito. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. And the guidelines for calling in are is to listen to your phone and not the show, because if you're watching the show, we're on an 8-second delay. That means I'm hanging up and you're going to have to be calling back. Also, lower the volume on your TV or computer or whatever device you're on so we don't get any feedback. And if you like, you know, you can leave your first name and the location where you're calling from, because we always like to know where you're calling from. And hopefully a lot of people from District 9 yes. are watching the show tonight, because we have New York Reform candidate Pierre Gooding. Pierre,
absolutely.
Welcome to the show again.
Thank you,
Pierre.
Pierre
was on a couple of weeks ago, was it? A couple of months ago?
About a month.
Yeah, and so now it's a couple of days to the election,
yes.
November 7th. And, you know, we like to provide Pierre some time. You know, Bill Perkins is too busy, even though we didn't ask him to come on the show. But from what I understand is he didn't even want to debate.
Yep.
But before we even get there, because there yep. might be some people who haven't seen the other
sure.
show, I know you should watch the other, should have watched the other show. But anyway, tell us a little about yourself.
Yes.
How old you are, where you grew up.
Yes.
Now a little bias, so people
sure.
get to know you like you, like, you know.
Yes.
Take it away.
Thank you so much. My name is Pierre Gooding. I was born in the Grant Houses in the 80s. And during that time, there was a crack epidemic. And the zone school that I was supposed to go to was not doing well. So my mother made the decision to leave the state so that I could have a good public school education. I came back to teach 6th and 8th grade English as a second language at IS 143 Eleanor Roosevelt Junior High in Washington Heights. And at that point, saw some inequities that we felt needed to be addressed. So 10 years ago, there was a lack of air conditioning in our classrooms and across the city. 10 years later, being legal counsel for a network of charter schools, we saw that there was still that injustice, a lack of air conditioning across the city, and that we needed to do more for our
so
students.
Even in the charter schools, there were lack of AC
No, this was in the traditional public school space, but that's sort of the point. We cannot have a difference in terms of the performance for charter schools and our traditional schools and for resources.
Okay.
And so
we'll get back to that.
So we'll get back,
yes. How you got into this.
Absolutely.
Your mother took you out of the city so you could get a good education
yes.
and don't have to worry about what was going on
yeah.
in your neighborhood.
Yeah.
And then you came back and you started to work here and you saw some inequities.
Seeing some of these inequities and fighting for some of this justice, making sure that there's an air conditioner in every classroom, making sure that we have libraries and librarians in our school district, which is a current pressing problem. But seeing some of these challenges and some of the community members coming and saying, it's time for you to run, our elected leadership right now is not doing enough for our folks. The 13% unemployment rate that we've had is stagnant over decades. We're at a point of a housing crisis, and our folks don't have quality schools. So between those three, we've got a real pressing crisis point
okay,
in Harlem.
And this is while you were working for charter schools, you saw that there was these problems going on, and this is what the is this the initial reason why
exactly.
you wanted to run? Or
absolutely.
The other?
Yeah, just seeing what was going on in my community. Now, shortly after deciding to run, we had an individual on the ballot who was scamming people on Craigslist, who we sent to jail on 10 counts of fraud. So it is about advocacy, and we do think that elected leadership has to be there to advocate. But the reason I'm in
this... honest.
And be honest. Well, absolutely. But it's not honest to say that if it's not broke, don't fix it. It is broken. Harlem is in need of leadership. Our community districts are reaching out and saying, can you help with this problem? For 2 years, we've been reaching out, trying to get elected leadership to focus on these libraries and librarians in our schools. What is more important, Lou, than our schools and libraries and librarians, books in our schools for our children?
Well, I think your mother answered that question.
No, exactly. And so we had to get my mother up here, along with a couple of reporters, and the Reform Party mayoral candidate, to come speak about these issues. And of course, the DOE showed up, and we had an honest conversation about why it took 2 years to get to a point where we were even getting the information.
So there's inequities in education system that the people up in Harlem aren't, the children, are being overlooked.
Yes. It's currently, when you have a situation where you have four libraries and two librarians in the school district, where this is reported, where the leadership is reaching out to our elected officials saying, please help us to solve this gross inequity and gross violation of state law, and nothing is happening, that's the problem. That's where parents say, we don't care who our elected leader is. It just has to be someone who's going to do something. That's why we're in this race. The community members are speaking up and saying enough is enough. We've just got to do better.
Okay. And what about, because I know in the last show, we'll get back to that, because, you know, it kind of like everything you're going to talk about ties into trying to make Harlem a better neighborhood, because there is the push for gentrification out there and everything else. And what I'm seeing is that you said that unemployment in Harlem is double digit against the rest of the city and stuff like that.
Yes.
So if you get elected, what's the first thing you're going to do? And how are you going to get these laws passed out? What's the point? Because that's always the thing. A lot of guys come in, you know, I'm going to do this and that. But isn't it different thing going on once you get elected, or what?
The first program that we would advocate for is a package to say to our businesses coming into the community, we want you to be a part of Harlem, but we want you to hire our folks. We're going to give you a tax break, a tax incentive to do it, but we want you to hire our people. And we think that there is enough of this happening in other districts besides Harlem, where we will have the numbers to actually pass this package. It will be in city councilors' interest to do it, because their community members will say, yes, we too want jobs. And if you can quantifiably bring that to the district, you will have shown that you can do something, and we will reelect you, as opposed to the current status where people don't even know what city council does. Lou, I am frightened at the level of or the lack of leadership at the city council level coming out of our district. It's not okay for our children. It's not okay for our parents. It's not okay for our community.
And even the infrastructure in the schools are here is like the lead problem that was in Flint is approaching here. That's what I hear. I don't know per se if that's the truth of what's going on in the school system or...
Do you care when we are getting these reports about resources, about infrastructure in our schools, about lead poisoning, about that possibility, about the fact that we do not have the rooms for libraries? Well, that's a problem, because there cannot be a conversation that says we don't have the infrastructure for a library. That's not okay.
So how did... When the Blasio say, you know, free pre-K, I mean, did Harlem have enough people to cover the... How did free pre-K affect Harlem? I mean, was it a positive thing, or there was too many kids for one person to handle? What else?
Well, free pre-K, let's talk about even that initiative for a second. Pre-K for All is a program that I am an advocate for. We have to ensure that our students are educated from an early age. And in even 3K, let's make sure 3K is in Harlem immediately, sooner rather than later. But going back to pre-K, there was a situation where Success Academy had to fight with the mayor's office over whether we were going to bring pre-K to Harlem. And this is the problem, Lou.
And that's who you were counsel for?
Yes.
Where
I was legal counsel. Yeah. And so instead of coming together as a community to make sure that our children are receiving the best education in the world, we're spending millions of dollars in court and legal fees fighting over issues that don't matter. And so that's the problem that I see. We have to recalibrate this entire... It does matter to somebody. It matters to a lot of people, but we have to make sure...
We're probably going to lose money if things go a certain way. Because usually people are against change because it affects their pocket.
Sure. Some organizations are going to lose out if I win elected office, because we're going to change some things. And there are going to be some winners as well. Our teachers are going to be winners, because we're going to make sure that we pay our teachers so that they will stay in the most difficult job in the world and teach our children in the most expensive city in the world. I mean, these things matter. Economics matter. And if you don't have a handle on economics in your community, things are going to go haywire very quickly.
Okay. So let's just go back. We talked about education for a while. You're talking about tax breaks, and I'm thinking, were you connecting tax breaks to hire people who are residents in the area?
Yes.
Is that what we're looking at is?
Yes. The program is to say we would like our residents to be employed in the community that they put 10 and 20 years sweat equity into, as opposed to being forced out because of the high real estate prices and the lack of ability to find a job. And this program is dedicated to reversing that problem.
But is that going to, because I know that on our previous show you said the average income in Harlem is $35,000.
Correct.
So if the job's coming in, do you see that $35,000 as an average being more, or are we looking of businesses coming in, forcing out mom and pops, and just paying people minimum wage?
Well, there's a couple of things. Along with getting these jobs, now you have to pair that with training and retraining programs so that your $35,000 job, which is a good paying job, is just the starting point, though.
Right.
And also making sure that we are cognizant that our median income is $35,000. So the programs that are dedicated to affordable housing in Harlem have to be set so that our Harlemites can afford them. Currently, the affordable programs are not affordable for Harlemites.
And we're connected. You got a tough job, and I think a lot of different city council members have the same job. Because when you're looking at a $35,000 income, where you're going to live, because with the gentrification coming on and people coming in, and what's going to happen? I mean you got a different initiatives to go just to tackle to get this going.
Well, what's going to happen? Lou, today an article just came out, and it was sent to me by the district leader, William Allen, because there is a problem in East Harlem. The landlord assistance program in a couple of buildings, particularly the Schomburg Plaza, is going to go offline. And when that happens, individuals are going to lose their housing because their apartments will go to market rate. And so this is the sort of advocacy that I'm talking about. Now, I've called on Bill Perkins to immediately state what his plans are to address this issue. Our folks are losing housing left and right. This is a crisis situation. And so if you do not have a plan to address this, you should not be running for city council. And I would encourage, I would implore our listeners, our voters, to ask our city councilors, including Bill Perkins, what the issues are that they plan to address and how they plan on getting there.
And our viewers out there, if you like to call us, 212-245-7273. You know, jump right in. Even
Please.
Though we're talking, we appreciate
Yes.
the phone calls. You know, you can interrupt our conversation. And if you don't want to call, you know, you go to Pierre's website, get the phone number, call in, or walk into his office,
Yes.
and say, you know what, I got these issues. Or I would say, what are you going to help us here? What are we going to do? Because I think it's good that people come and meet you personally.
Yes.
Because, you know, a show is one thing, but shaking somebody's hand, you can really get a feeling for the person.
Absolutely. And we encourage our people to come up to Harlem. If you're not a resident, come be a part of the joyous place that is Harlem. If you are a resident, please come and speak to us about the issues. We are here for that purpose, and your city council person should be there taking care of the macro and micro level issues. That's what matters, not a jacked up city council salary and not a title. It's about effective leadership.
Yeah, and that's not bad. Was it about $150,000?
It's not bad at all. It's unfortunate. I wish they would lower. I would call for them to lower that salary to 30 or 40 grand. I'd do it for free. I know there's some other folks that can't, so let's...
Don't get me wrong. When I was a little kid, I thought the people who were in government did it for free because it was a privilege.
It is a privilege.
It's a privilege.
It is a privilege.
People lose sight of that.
It is a privilege, Lou. And when the state senate salary is $78,000 and the city council salary is $150,000, the numbers don't add up. And so you get people running for the wrong reasons.
And plus the perks from the real estate industry.
Well, yeah, I mean, look. And this is what's so...
I really don't want to make light of this.
No.
It's an issue of basically integrity.
It is. And this is what's so important, Lou. We have to have individuals running for the right reasons. We have to have people choosing elected officials because they're running for the right reasons. And so it's about researching your candidates, knowing who your candidates are, picking who is best.
Okay, so go on this topic of integrity, because
Yes.
you know your opponent, Bill Perkins, has been in the legislature before.
Yes.
And various things. And so he must have, you know, and he has all these endorsements.
Yeah.
So to me, I think it's a staggering thing to get to, because, you know, it's almost, you know, if you get the Democratic nomination for anything, it's most of the time a shoo-in.
Mm-hmm.
So what is it about Bill Perkins that you think that he's offline on, you could do better with, and why people should vote for you and not for Bill?
Yeah,
or the Republican candidate or the other candidate.
Sure. I think it's about advocacy. 10 years ago, I was teaching students, and Bill Perkins was using the N-word in front of school children. Now, this is what I'm talking about. There's a clear juxtaposition between the two candidates in terms of education, in terms of the future of Harlem, what we want to see for Harlem. We have plans that we have laid out, and I would challenge our constituents to ask the Perkins camp what their plans are for the future of Harlem. And if they do not have any, that is a sign that there's change necessary in our district.
Well, I also heard that, you know, he's not showing up for debates. You said, and so we really don't know what Bill wants to do.
No one in the community knows what Bill wants to do, and that's a problem. We need to backwards plan. We do not have the resources to waste. We do not have the resources for $1 million to go disappearing in the district. We have to use every dollar, every cent efficiently so that we can curb this 12% unemployment rate, so that we can have quality housing and quality education. This is too important to sit idly by while a city council person collects a paycheck. It's too important, Lou.
And going back to the housing part, as you know, de Blasio has this next-gen housing projects going on, which is, I think, one that's on the river, like 101st Street, but that's not your district.
No.
But basically, are there any plans like that in your district?
There are plenty of plans. There are plenty of plans, Lou. The problem is we have to be in the room to make sure the plans work for Harlemites. As these changes come online, and they are going to, they're happening now, they've happened, they're going to continue to happen, we have to be in the room. That is the most important thing we can do. We can be there to negotiate. You want to be a part of this community? Great. But what are you going to give to the individuals that put so much into this community to make it the greatest place in the world so that you wanted to come here? We have to do that process. And when you're not there, what you allow is a situation where anyone can take, where individuals feel that it's okay to change the entire name of the district, and there's no pushback. And so that can't happen. We have to have effective leadership.
And talking about leadership and the community and the police department, how is relationships with the police now? And is there any changes that you're looking forward to if you get elected? Or
absolutely. Our relations with the NYPD currently are fairly good. I was having a conversation with a civilian officer yesterday about community relations, and we both agree that for the most part, Harlem is where it needs to be. Now, what has to get better are the soft interactions, the soft skills in terms of people on a day-to-day basis, knowing their community members feeling like they can come to NYPD with a situation, feeling like they're comfortable. That's what the community told us during the community forum last November.
Mm-hmm.
But the point was that we had the community forum to figure out what the issues were so that we could then go and proactively be a part of change. You have to quantifiably do this as well. You need data. We have the information from our folks who attended the meeting so that we can then follow up, but you have to have those data points. There's no data being collected
without data, what's there to talk about?
What is there?
And
exactly.
You have to make sure that the data hasn't been filtered or massaged.
Absolutely.
Because you know what they say? What they say is, liars figure and figures lies. Something like that. And you know what? Being and looking at, you know, during my job in the major corporations is you look at reports coming by every day. And when I look at some, I say, this doesn't look right. No, because people want to fudge. They want to look good in front of everybody. And it's hard to tell what reports you're looking at, what numbers you're looking at is right. Hopefully you'll get the data and it'll be good.
You got to mine the data carefully, but it's a useful exercise. You got to get the data, and you've got to make sure that you can get something out of it. But it's useful.
You know, I'm a native New Yorker, and I was born over in New York Hospital, And the thing that I always see for everybody who's running, we're going to get affordable housing, we're going to, you know, talk to the real estate industry, but it never happens. Everybody gets elected, real estate industry is still going, still doing whatever they need to do, and now we're at the point where middle class Americans, I mean, New Yorkers, can't live. I mean, a small little apartment from in my neighborhood is $3,000 a month.
Yes.
Well, Lou, so how are you going to take on this big thing? I mean, how are you going to go after the real estate industry?
One, I believe what you're talking about is one reason why we need term limits. I do believe that after a certain amount of time, people become entrenched. Big money does take over and influence people's lives as opposed to what is in the public good and public interest. And so I believe 4 or 8 years is a significant amount of time, a sufficient amount of time to create some positive change and pass it on to the next individual. I do believe that that takes care of some of what you're talking about in terms of big money controlling votes.
I'm going to be nice because I don't want to put your feet to the fire to this because it's going to be hard.
It's going to be hard, but
because it's never, I never seen it move anywhere.
But Lou, we can't stop fighting. And
I just want you to do something.
You
do it, and I want to say, yeah, go get him, Pierre.
But you know, this is what our community says. They say the people come out, they make promises, and we never see them again. And it's hard to fight against that because you can't make promises if you're not going to keep them, and no one wants to hear any more promises. But what I can say is that our track record shows that we're about action and not so much about the words. An individual reached out to me and said, this state Senate candidate is scamming people, and people said, you can't touch him. He's a politician. He said, well, if he's doing wrong, we're going to make sure that he gets what he deserves. And so that's what it's about. You have to advocate when it's necessary, and you cannot stop fighting because it's difficult and because people haven't done things the right way in the past. We won't do it because it's too important, and I believe over time people are going to see that we're about action.
All right, so with the real estate thing, I don't see the connection with term limits.
You get entrenched. You get entrenched after 15 and 20. Yeah, but that recently came online, and that's a good thing.
Right.
But what I'm saying is that as someone who's coming in, I'm not beholden to millions of dollars of special interest money. So I don't have a problem telling entity A, B, or C, you're dead wrong, and we have to make sure our people have a place to live,
mm-hmm.
Which I do believe separates our candidacy from some of the other ones out there, including Bill Perkins. This is well known that Mr. Perkins and the real estate industry are very cozy. It's not something that I'm sort of disclosing for the first time.
Real estate industry tries to be cozy with everyone.
Absolutely.
You know what? Because it's an overinflated market.
Well,
I mean, people's making money and they just don't care. And I'm just saying is that maybe I'm pessimistic about it, all right? But you have your work cut out for you.
Yes.
Because the real estate industry, like a lot of things, so it's even as you see nationally here, the greed and the corruptness as it's playing out
in
the news. But it's how are you going to stop real estate from building a building and say, you know what, you're going to build this building, we want 75% affordable housing, somebody who's making 40 grand a year.
Well,
because you know what, because the housing people, the landlords who want to sell their property, say, I'm losing money, I don't want to do this. Well, how do we get this all done?
Let's separate out. Let's not say the real estate industry, because just like every other space, there are good and bad actors in the real estate space. And the reason I say that is because one of my best friends is in the real estate space and wants to do things the right way, wants to work with elected leadership to build housing that, of course, they can profit off of, but also has a significant amount of affordable units. So this is possible, and there are people who want to do the work, but are we there to advocate and are we there to make these deals? It takes some creativity. It takes some planning.
Right.
Do we know how to do it?
And does the city actually have control? Is it true that some of the state legislature has control over some of some of this?
Absolutely,
as well?
Yes. We know that the Erstad rule is on the books, and that there are very stringent real estate laws statewide that come into play, and it's something that we advocate for more city control over this aspect because it's important. Aspects are in play, and it's the reason why housing is not an easy subject in New York City or anywhere else, but it's incredibly important. If we do not have a place for our individuals to sleep, it's going to be very hard for that individual to find a job, to send his or her daughter to school, and have this type of stability.
Everything is connected.
It's all connected, Lou.
Yeah, and you know, this person, the savior, was supposed to be de Blasio. He hasn't even accomplished this.
Well, we've got some problems still, Lou. We've got some problems still. And so it just quantifiably, when we take a look at what's going on, the numbers, the all-time high rate in homelessness.
You got 30 seconds.
We got 30 seconds. Well, look.
I think we covered pretty much the gamut.
Yeah.
Let's just go back. What's the first thing you're going to do? Besides kicking Bert Perkins out of office.
Absolutely. When we are elected as city council persons, we will lower the 13% unemployment rate, make sure that we have quality schools in Harlem, and make sure that people have a place to live. My name is Pierre Gooding, and I'm running for city council in District 9 Harlem, and I appreciate your time tonight, and please go out and vote on Tuesday, November 7th.
Great, and I get just one more question. Am I going to be invited to your party when
yes,
you win? All
yes,
right,
yes.
I got to get a ticket to
you. Lou, you will be there. Lou will be there, be in Harlem soon. So you'll see him walking around with me, shaking hands, because he loves Harlem as much as I do.
I love everybody.
Yes,
we got to help each other.
We have to.
And what we lost here with this administration, I mean, in national and stuff, people just a lot of hate. And what you bring and what other people trying to bring here, going outside of the Democratic Party, is to make change.
Yeah.
And with people like you, we can stop the rain, and all we need is love.
Thank
you, Pierre, for coming. Thanks for watching, everybody.